Being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved through the wrath through him. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved through his life. And so there is no judgment for sin for the believer. So when we stand before the judgment seat of Christ, we're going to be judged for our servanthood, not our sin. Sin was taken care of at Calvary. Okay. Also, our faith means that God gives the believer victory over fear and despair and fills him with love and joy and peace instead. Amen. That's wonderful. Really, you think about it, all unsaved people live in fear, and they do. They have no hope. And they literally live in fear. And I tell you what, as this world gets worse and worse and worse, watch how the unbelievers react. They're scared. They are scared, as we'd say, to death. Rightly so, because they have no hope. See, we don't fear anything. Yeah, well, you know, my Bible tells me that as the closer the coming of Christ, the worse it's going to get. It's not going to get any better. Do I fear that? No, I get excited knowing, oh boy, any day. Yeah. It's clouds today. You never know.
But they're following a delusion, though, too. You know, there's this, like, mass delusion that they're all following that, you know, government's going to take care of you.
Yeah, I know.
Everything's going to be okay.
Yeah. You're right. Yeah, I know.
That scares you.
John 14:27 says, "Peace I live with you, leave with you. My peace I give unto you, not as the world gives." Yeah. Right, there you go. "Give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither be it afraid." John 14:27. Now in context, what's interesting, John 14, he's talking to the disciples. He said, "Let not your heart be troubled." What were they troubled about? Many things. Judas betrayed Christ. All right, they were troubled about that. They were troubled because the inner three were fighting who was going to be better in heaven. There was fighting in the camp. All right. Thomas
is always doubting.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. Philip
was always arguing.
Yeah. Yeah, the sons of thunders wanted to kill everybody. They didn't want to believe in Christ. I mean, it's no wonder they were troubled. Okay, they knew that also that the rulers of that day were trying to kill Jesus. Okay, every time he did something, there was something, you know, Satan was around the corner with something trying to kill him. So that troubled them. And the worst of all, he's saying, "I'm going to leave you guys." That's what really troubled them. What? You're leaving us? Wait a minute. You promised us a kingdom.
And he helped them.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and he said, "By the way, I'm going to die. I'm going to leave you." What? What do you mean you're going to die?
I'm going to send you a helper.
Yeah, yeah. So they were troubled.
But I think Satan, too, uses that fear continually in the world today. You know, fear of, fires out in California, earthquakes, hurricane season.
Yeah.
It's like they get everybody like all in this tizzy, and he's just loving it because the focus is not on
Christ, not on the gospel.
Or heaven. It's on,
exactly.
Oh my gosh, you know, we're doomed.
That's. Well, we're talking about that in the van. It says, you know, it's interesting, the media. Yeah, with all these scare tactics, it's all a bunch of garbage.
It is.
I'm telling you, this government could shut down for 2 years, and there's no problem. Nobody is hurting.
No.
But it's that fear. The media is bringing people. Where? I don't see people suffering.
Yeah.
Where's the suffering? Who's suffering? Oh, the poor people, the senators in Congress aren't getting paid. Oh, that's their suffering. You know. But fear. Yeah. See, that's the fear.
Yeah.
All they're doing is breeding fear in the people. That's all they're doing.
Consistent. I mean, it's like the Sandy Hook, and I mean, it's just like, oh my gosh, you can't send your children to school.
I know.
Back to
Yeah.
I was talking with my 1 in 1,000,000.
There's more people die in car accidents than in.
Don't drive a car.
I know. It's nuts. Yeah, go ahead.
No, I was going to mention when you were talking about Jesus and telling his disciples that he's going to die. Along that subject line, I watch Fox News, and occasionally I catch Bill O'Reilly. His latest book out is Killing Jesus.
Yeah.
You know, he's done the Killing Lincoln.
And yep.
Killing Kennedy, and now it's Killing Jesus. I haven't read the book. I can't say for certain what precisely is in it. But I wonder, because he does make it known that he is Catholic.
He's Catholic, yeah.
I just wonder if he's not being taught the fact that Jesus was predestined to die before he even came on the earth.
Yeah. Well, if I understand him, he said this book is a book, it's just factual, historical stuff. It has got nothing to do with the Bible. All right? It's got nothing to do with the Bible. But I'm sure there's some stuff in it.
It's not theological.
It says it's not theologically. Yeah. Yeah. So.
How can you do something like that and not be?
Yeah, yeah, and yeah.
Bill,
I got one person mad a couple of months ago. So I said, listen, Bill O'Reilly's not saved.
No.
He's not a born-again believer. No. But people, when you write a book like that, you think, oh, man, he must be a Christian, you know.
Well, that deceit. There's deceit.
Yeah. Yeah. I think if you go online, I think there's a professor, I forget his name, that's already read the book and just tore it apart. He tore the book. He said, this is not even theologically correct. You know? So, yeah. So, fear. Our faith gives us victory over fear. Jesus said in John 16:33, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. As long as you're alive, we're going to experience problems. Mark it down, believer. You will have trials and tribulations. Don't say, oh, Lord, take it. No, Lord ain't going to take it away. God's got them there for a purpose, to grow you in Christ.
Wish he would.
Yeah, I know. When the trials come, say, Lord, what do you want me to learn? Teach me. I'll learn it, and then we'll move on.
Yeah.
To the next
trial. Yeah.
Say like I do, Lord, whatever it is, get through the hard head quick, because I'm not long at things.
Yeah.
Teach me quick, Lord. I want to learn fast.
Yeah. Yeah.
Accelerated program.
Yeah, I'd like that.
Every day, yeah, accelerated
program. I was never smart enough for the accelerated education in school, but I'll take it, Lord, with you.
The one thing that I try to get into believers' minds is this. You don't know how long a trial and tribulation is going to last. All right? But if it seems like it's a long time, I always say, well, go back and read the book of Job. You think you got it bad?
Yeah.
Job. You think you got it bad? Have you lost all your children? Have you lost all your income? You got a wife that says, won't you just curse God and die? That's not pleasant.
Or friends.
Have three friends like that. I'd rather have three enemies. Those rascals, you know. That guy went through, you know. You think he got it bad? You want to go through what the Apostle Paul went through? Just the tortures and the beatings alone.
You know, when the unsaved world seems to go through the trials.
They watch.
And they see it. And then they see how you have victory over it.
Yeah.
How you even handle it.
Yep.
How you're able to kind of defend yourself, articulate, you know, what your whole position is on something.
Yeah.
Marvel at this. I believe God gives you the words to say.
He does. And the unsaved are watching it, and that's how. And then they say, "Wow, I want what they got." Even in Noah, I thought it was really cool when the family, you know, while he's building the ark, all that family, they're all mocking him, making fun of him, and And I'm thinking, yeah, that's trial and tribulation. How many years? Ooh.
Banging on the door
for 300 years.